topic which we're discussing, lessons from the epics, should we have them in our textbooks? So I wanted to open the discussion and begin with Amish. How do you decide which version of the epic works? If you were to set the textbooks of, say, the NCRT textbooks tomorrow, how would you decide which version of the Ramayana and which version of the Mahabharata to take?
One of the central tenets of the Indian way for millennia was that we were a very decentralized culture. It's one of the reasons I think that we are an anti-fragile country, to use Nassim Nicholas Taleb's immortal term. Of many of the ancient civilizations that started their journey to civilization with us, Mesopotamia, Greece, all of them are museum pieces today. They're dead. And Greece, of course, came later, but Egypt, Mesopotamia, all of them. They're all museum pieces today. We are the only ones who are still around. I think one of the reasons, there are various reasons that we survived. I think we knew the difference between non-violence and pacifism, for example. That's one reason. Various reasons, but one of the reasons I think that we survived was we were a decentralized culture, which doesn't mean that there is no connection. It just means that a sunflower is free to be a sunflower, a rose is free to be a rose, a lotus is free to be a lotus. A lotus is not going to say the rose and the sunflower better convert into a lotus or we're going to behead them, and that's nonsense. But it doesn't mean that there is no string which attaches them into a garland together, the garland which makes up our great country, Bharat. If you see it from this perspective, then there are various different versions of the Ramayana, and all of which connect with each other. And the actual story itself does not matter as much as what we learn about Dharma from those Ramayans. So I say, let it be free. Let people, like our ancient Gurukuls that existed. The Ramayana and Mahabharata were like the introductory texts, the first standard, where you learn various various subjects also, like Shanti Parva and Mahabharata is like a civics lesson. Sugriv speaking to his subordinates where to search for Sita Ma is actually like a geography lesson. So you learn those basics, but most importantly, you learn various facets of Dharma. So we can celebrate the Kamba Ramayanam in, in Tamil Nadu. We can have the Ramcharitmanas in UP. We can have the Valmiki Ramayana, across India, whoever wants to celebrate. And there's no harm in having various different versions, because in all of them, we learn lessons on Dharma.
Bibek, you chose the critical Mahabharata to translate, which itself is, I think, a synthesis of over 1,000 different versions. Why did you choose that? And would you recommend that if you were told tomorrow to set the textbook of NCRT or a local school, a local state board? What would you choose?
I'll take the second part of the question a bit later. Hmm. And good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And thank you for this opportunity. First, let's understand the Sanskrit text, and then I'll answer your question. In Sanskrit, there is only one Mahabharata, composed by Vedavyasa, except that there were around 1,215 different versions of the Sanskrit Mahabharata floating around in different parts of the country, which differed a little bit from each other. Very marginal differences, but there were over 1,215. In the year 1916, the Bhandarkar Oriental Research Institute in Pune began an exercise to try and sift through these 1,215 different versions to try and see what might be the closest to the original. And this they did on the basis of something very similar to what we studied in school in mathematics, highest common factor, HCF. In other words, if a shloka occurred in a maximum number of versions, it was likely to be one of the original ones, something that we are familiar with in genetic work as well. This exercise started in 1916, was concluded in 1966, took 50 years, and this is known as the critical edition. What I am engaged in, as Kaveree suggested, as told you, is to translate from the Sanskrit to English. So obviously I did not want to translate 1215 different versions. It was natural for me to use the critical Mahabharata. I said that for the Mahabharata there was only one. On the Sanskrit, there are 4.5 versions of the Ramayana, of which the Valmiki Ramayana is one. I said half because there is the Ramopakhyan also in the Mahabharata. I've counted that as a half.
Why is that?
It's part of the Mahabharata. It's a small thing. Right. It counts as a half. Exactly similarly, the Baroda Oriental Research Institute in the late 70s sat down with about 200 different versions of the Valmiki Ramayana, not the others, and produced a critical version, so I translated that. Now, answering the question, I don't know whether it should be in text or whether it should be outside text. I do strongly feel that children should be aware of what these texts say. You use the word epics. I don't like the word epics. I would prefer the word itihasa because that is the expression that is used to describe them. Itihasa. They are not myths. Itihasa is this is indeed what happened. Let me give you an example. There was a poet, dramatist, famous once upon a time in Bengal, known as Michael Madhusudan Datta. He wrote in English originally, later on started to write in Bengali. He was unhappy, as several people have been, with the way Valmiki depicted various characters. And he wrote his own version of the Ramayana story known as Meghnad Bodh Kabbo. Meghnad Bodh Kabbo was so popular at one point in time, expressions from Meghnad Bodh Kabbo have passed into the Bengali language. Except, today, people use those words, people use those expressions, but today's younger generation no longer remembers that these were from Meghnad Bodh Kabbo. Today's generation no longer reads Meghnad Bodh Kabbo. And that is my concern. It's not so much the Sanskrit. As Amish said, there were vernacular versions. Today we have a generation which neither reads the Sanskrit nor does it read the vernacular. So they have very warped versions of what, to use your words, the epics contain. And that is my concern.
So how do you address that? What can one do? You'll have to overhaul the education system?
Well, the first thing we should do is all of us here should collectively agree that this needs to change. If we agree it needs to change, the change will begin to happen. The trouble, of course, is that we are not agreed that this is a vacuum that needs to be filled. We seem to be completely oblivious of the fact that today's younger generation does not read all of this stuff until it comes to us in the English language from the West, preferably on social media.
Amish, would you agree with that? And how would one address that?
You know, it's not just about pride in our motherland. I've said this, you know, I think countless number of times. One of the misfortunes of India is many Indian liberals have not realized that our ancient culture is their biggest ally. They haven't realized it because they haven't read our ancient texts. If you want to fight the cause of liberalism, fight the cause of women's rights, fight the cause of LGBT rights, you'll find our ancient culture is actually a fantastic ally for this. For that, we have to make our youngsters aware of our ancient texts, either through interpretations or ideally the original texts. There has to be some way to make them aware. Secondly, it's not just about the soft liberal causes. It's also the real impact that we as Indians suffer because our education system disconnects us from our own roots, disconnects us from the reality of India. Our education system works at somehow making us into European. Kuch bhi karke, turn them into Britishers, right? So for example, so many Indians, you see the way our urban structures are organized. They do not take the monsoons into account, right? Our ancestors were obsessed by the monsoon. The word for year, Varsh, was derived from the word for monsoon, Varsha, correct? Because the flow of the monsoons defined our climate. But our urban structures don't account for that at all. When you have an attitude that we desperately want to be European, our architects build glass wall buildings, which makes sense in Western Europe where there's a shortage of the sun. In India, we don't have a shortage of the sun, boss. We have an excess of the sun.
So
there is a real world impact of a colonial education system, of a system which disconnects us from the realities of India. There's such little respect for rivers, such little respect for for the mountains, for the trees, for nature, which is a part of our ancient culture, because we are importing a westernized approach of looking at nature as a resource.
But both of you are products of the same system. Are you outliers, or are you just brilliant products?
I will not answer for Bibek, but I have remained Indian because of my family. Because my family is obsessively Indian. My grandfather was a pandit in Kashi. And our family was very clear that our generation was the first one to be educated in the English medium. My parents were educated in the Hindi medium. And they had talent, but they wouldn't get good jobs. So my parents were clear that we are not going to let our children suffer. So they sent us to English medium schools. But they were also clear that when you come back home, we will be Indian here. We'll speak only in our language. We will learn our culture. We will not forget it. No, so that was a result of the family. It's not a result of the education system. So for example, in our family, we knew that India has six seasons. But in school, we are taught the nonsense that India has four seasons.
Did you ever feel like getting up and telling your teacher?
I'd asked that once in the second standard, because we were told India has four seasons: spring, summer, autumn, and winter. And I'd asked in the second standard. I don't know, is everyone taught the same thing even now?
Yes.
That India has four seasons.
Yes.
Yeah, Europe has four seasons. India actually has six seasons. And when I learned this in the second standard, I'd raise my hand. I'd said, "Ma'am, where's monsoon in this? Because I can see the rains, no?" So my teacher said, "You shut up," So I'd gone home, and my mother told me, "No, in your exams you will write what you're taught."
Yeah.
But at home we know what the truth is, correct? So we are taught to compromise with what we know is nonsense, because we need good marks and that will help us get good jobs. But at fault is the system itself. You can't blame kids for for not knowing the realities of India when nothing is taught to them, when they are actively taught to just cut themselves from the roots.
Maybe you have managed to strike that balance again very beautifully. Your education is both deeply rooted, as well as you've had the best of a Western education as well. Have you had moments like what Amish has just described, where you have felt that the person who's teaching you is speaking absolute nonsense and you really feel like correcting them?
Kaveree, you are personalizing it. I'm not sure how much of interest
I think
this
it is interesting.
Hang on, hang on, hang on. But maybe it is of interest. Because my upbringing was somewhat different, not like Amish's. And I constantly regret it.
You do?
Yes, I do. And I hope the younger generation does not realize there is cause for regret at the age of 40 as I did. And that's part of the reason these kinds of sessions should be held. I studied at the Ramakrishna Mission School much later.
Yeah, first you went to...
First education was in what is called a Western missionary school, where we recited the Lord's Prayer every morning, mandatorily. No PIL was filed about that. And I was completely blissfully unaware of the existence of this treasure that existed. I mentioned Michael Madhusudan Datta earlier. One of the first poems he wrote was, "I sigh for Albion's distant shore." I told you he wrote in English originally before he discovered Bengali much later. Maybe I was destined to do the same because we share the same birthday, not you. Michael Madhusudan Datta and I.
Wow.
I'll bore you to death by giving you an anecdote about how I first got interested. And I'll bore you to death because I'm going to quote two Sanskrit shlokas, which, rest assured, I will translate. The first Sanskrit shloka is from the Valmiki Ramayana. In the Valmiki Ramayana, as everyone knows, Rama already knows that Sita is in Lanka. But since Amish mentioned the monsoons, I was reminded of that. Rama knows Sita is in Lanka. He is waiting to invade, but he has to wait because it's the monsoon. It's showering down. The rains have to stop before he can actually invade. And Valmiki was a beautiful poet who described nature much more than Veda Vyasa ever did. And this is the Sanskrit. Vidyut pataka savalaka mala shailendra koota kriti sannikasha garjanti megha samudirna nada matta gajendra evasang yugastha. Here are the clouds, the monsoon clouds which are thundering. They are tinged with flags of lightning, garlanded with cranes, and they resemble what? They resemble elephants. And what are these elephants doing? The elephants are fighting. Next poet, Kalidasa. We have not been able to date either, but they were probably separated in time by about 500 years. Kalidasa wrote a minor kavya called Meghadutam. There is no story in the Meghadutam. The story in the Meghadutam is only about a yaksha who has committed some minor transgression and has been banished by his lord and master Kuvera to exile for 1 year. And while he is there, he is pining for his beloved who is in Kuvera's capital of Alakapuri. He sees a cloud and he sends that cloud as a messenger to Alakapuri to carry his message to his beloved. That's all, no story. So it's all a beauty, it's a description of nature. The beauty, the first part, the cloud goes. The second part, the cloud comes back. Right towards the beginning. Asharasya prathama divase megham ashlishta sanum vapra krira parinata gaja prekshaniyam dadarsha. Here is the yaksha looking at the clouds on the first day of Ashar. And what do the clouds remind him of? The clouds remind him of elephants. But what are the elephants doing? They are playing. And it sort of hit me. Here are these two poets separated by 500 odd years. They think of the clouds, they see the clouds, they're describing the clouds, and the only image that comes to them, the obvious image that comes to them, is of elephants. And here is Rama who's waiting to fight, and the elephants for him are fighting. And here is the yaksha who is pining for his beloved, and for him the elephants are playing. I chanced upon these two shlokas and I thought that if I do not read this literature, I am missing out on something in life. So I started learning Sanskrit at the rather late age of 40. And that is what I meant by regret, that the younger lot who are there,
yeah,
at the back,
right there.
Please do not make this mistake. 40 is too late to start.
I think that calls for a round of applause, although they seem very troubled. I think they're thinking, my God, we better start tomorrow. But Amish, really, have you also had such an aha moment where you thought, my God, I have to do something about this. I have to bring this to life. I have to bring
In terms
Ram
of our
life.
Culture or
No, in terms of your writing.
writing was not really an aha moment. It just began as, you know, as pure philosophies, you know, and then it kind of grew into the story. But for me, the upbringing that I had actually led to various aha moments. One was, of course, like what I've spoken about already, what all I learned at home. But I was born in Mumbai. My early years were in Odisha. And then my parents sent me to a boarding school in Tamil Nadu. And my father's family is originally from Kashi. Now, the beauty of this experience meant like I learned different interpretations of the same story at a very young age, right? Like in the south, who's elder, Lord Ganesh or Lord Karthik? Everyone agrees? Any North Indian here? What do you think? Who's Lord Karthik?
Karthik
okay,
is supposed
South
to be
Indians,
the
please don't beat up the North Indians. He's actually right. In North India, it is actually believed that Lord Karthik is elder. But in South, it's believed Lord Ganesh is elder. Now, is Lord Karthik a bachelor or does he have wives? Two wives, right? Valli ji and Sena ji. North Indians? North Indians?
He's a bachelor.
He's a bachelor, right?
Yeah.
He's a bachelor. Now, I discovered this at a very... Yeah, exactly. I discovered this at a very young age. Because I studied in Tamil Nadu in a school close to Udhakamandalam. And so I heard this. And then I... First, holiday had gone back. I asked my parents, hello, what's going on? You told me Lord Karthik was a bachelor. But I was told he has two wives. When did this happen? Okay. Now, so you... At a very young age, I learned this fundamental truth and the beauty of the Indian way that we intrinsically respect multiple truths. We are not the kind who will say, if you don't believe in this truth, you will go to hell or I will kill you. We don't have that kind of attitude. And I'm saying this is true of all people, most people in India across all religions. We intrinsically learn multiple truths, right? And therefore, we learn respect for different points of view. This actually impacted my being, my character, at a very young age. Now, if you think about this, I just learned it by accident. Because I learned so much from home. And then I traveled and I studied in various places. Why can't this be taught as a part of the education system? This was an aha moment for me coming here. And now when I hear different interpretations, I don't get troubled. I went to Southeast Asia. I found various different interpretations of our epics out there. If you go to Thailand, many of the rural Thailand believe that actually, some of them believe that Lord Ram was actually from there. Fair enough, they have a right to their point of view, correct? They love Lord Ram as much as we love Lord Ram. Why can't this be a part of the system itself, rather than it being a part of accidental learning? And it's not just spirituality, in so many sciences, mathematics, there's a wealth of knowledge that our ancestors have left behind for us.
Yes. Talk a little about that, Amish, because you've both of you have spoken about this before, that what we know is only a small portion of what is out there.
Another pop quiz I'll do, then I'll leave the floor for Bibek da to speak on this, because he knows a lot more of the knowledge that we have. But pop quiz. The mother culture of Europe is the Greek civilization, right? Everyone agrees? Guess how many ancient Greek manuscripts survive till today? Zero. Not zero, but between 20 to 30,000 ancient Greek manuscripts. It gives you a sense of the knowledge production of the ancient Greeks. Guess how many ancient Sanskrit manuscripts survive till today? Despite the destruction of the Nalanda University, Takshashila University, Mahodayapuram, which was in the south, Tanjore when it was attacked, the Khiljis, we lost so much knowledge at that time. Udaygiri in Kalinga, so much Ujjaini, those universities that were destroyed, so much knowledge was lost. Despite that, guess how many Sanskrit manuscripts survive till today? Someone said lakhs? How many lakhs? Huh? 2 lakhs? Few lakhs? You want to put a specific number to it? What do you say? 30, 40 lakhs. What's your name, buddy? Huh? Girish. Applause for Girish. That is the knowledge production our ancestors had. And think of classical... And this is only Sanskrit. What the National Manuscript Mission has collated.
Yeah.
There are scholars who say there are probably much more. And there are other classic, Tamil is a classical language. There are so many other manuscripts. Now, these are things which need to be studied.
Which
they
are
need
not
to be
even
translated.
Digitized, exactly. Not translated.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah, I think things liven up if we disagree. We tend to most of the time. This time we will disagree. By the way, zero for Greek was sort of partially right in the sense that some of these were translated back.
Oh.
Fair, it went to Arabia and came.
In that sense, that was not terribly, terribly long. There's something called the National Manuscript Mission, NAMAMI. NAMAMI is in the business of, at the moment, just listing manuscripts. Digitization, translation, all of that will come later. Happening. At the moment, NAMAMI is just listing. And a manuscript, Puthi, is defined as something that is more than 75 years old. At the moment, NAMAMI has listed 3.5 million. 3.5 million listing. Estimates are that there are 40 million as against the 20,000 of the Greek corpus. Out of this 40 million, 2/3 are in Sanskrit. Some are in other languages like Pali. Out of this 40 million, 95% have not been translated. Ever. So we don't even know what kind of knowledge exists. To benchmark that 40 million figure, the UN has an estimate of the number of books that have been published in any language in the world since the beginning of printing post Gutenberg. Any language in the world. And that is 130 million. 130 million, 40 million here. 95% not never having been translated. Kautilya's Arthashastra was something that was known only by name until Shyamasastri discovered it in 1905 and translated it. So heaven knows what exists in this treasure trove of knowledge waiting to be translated by the younger generation. I have a manuscript, probably 12th century. It is called Chorya Shastram, never been translated. Chorya Shastram, as the name implies, is a manual for thieves.
Wow.
Were I to translate it, it would run into a volume of 350 printed pages. So, to reiterate, enormous amount of knowledge not even translated, and I'm not even talking about the knowledge that used to be handed down through oral transmission, which has disappeared and is increasingly disappearing.
Exactly. Though I would like to disagree that actually we agreed. I said 30, 40 lakhs, you said 3.5 million. I just didn't know the 40 million number. That's an estimate.
But Amish, you also made the point some time ago.
But it's
to
just
me.
The amount of knowledge our ancestors have left for us.
And
we are morons. We are morons that we have not even studied it. We don't even acknowledge it. We are morons.
But you also made the point that you not only need linguistic scholars, but you also need domain
that's true,
experts
that's true.
In that
you know, because,
field.
Because many of
say
these
medicine or
yeah, many of
know,
these manuscripts
thieving,
are actual scientific
Bibek's,
are actually scientific texts. You know, sorry, go ahead.
But there's a little bit more than that because remember the language may have been Sanskrit, but Sanskrit in written form is of recent vintage.
Exactly.
And even though the language may have been Sanskrit, it was written in different scripts. Some of these scripts are scripts for which we no longer have people who can read those scripts. I will deliberately not mention that specific script by name, but there is one script where we had no one alive who could read that script.
You're talking about
and
the Modi
six
script.
People have been trained from Heidelberg to read that script now.
Like some of them, many of them are scientific texts, are medical texts, you know, are mathematical texts. So you don't just need someone who can translate. Yeah. You also need a subject matter expert.
Right.
Because the
you
translator
were giving,
may not
you
know.
You were giving examples of the distinctions that could arise, which people could be foxed by.
No, the problem that happens, and Bibek Da can speak on this, you know, much more knowledgeably, is that our ancestors loved the concept of not communicating things directly. You know, they like to communicate things poetically, right? Which makes many texts very complex. You know, so instead of saying, I'd given one example, instead of saying like a chemistry text, this is just an example, I'm not saying I've read it somewhere. Instead of saying you have to put two drops of something in there, they may say you have to drop two Vishakha in there. Vishakha is a constellation with two stars. Now you're supposed to be able to decode. Why do they do this? They just like poetry. Our ancestors did. They like complex stuff. So it calls for high quality scholarship, you know, to be able to actually translate this so that we can understand. And there's a vast treasure house, how much comparative advantage it could give to our country, how it could bind us, how it could unite us.
Why
shouldn't Ponin Silvan be read by people in the north?
Yeah.
Why shouldn't Mahasamar be read by people in the south? These, and they're all, you know, around the same love for the soil of this land. It'll bind us also, even the literature.
We are sort of deviating a bit from the main topic, but nonetheless, let me make this point. That on these translations, if we don't do the translations, I think it's a bad argument only to criticize people from the West at doing bad translations because they haven't understood. Sanskrit in particular, one has to be a little bit careful because dharma and gharma, it is very easy if you do not notice the matra to get it completely wrong. On the Mahabharata, let me give you an example and then maybe we should come back to the main topic. On the Mahabharata, people are constantly surprised when I tell them that there are only three unabridged translations of the Mahabharata in English.
Of which yours is one.
Of which mine is one. The others are all abridged translations. There was an attempt by Professor Van Buitenen to translate the Mahabharata. This is the Chicago one. He died halfway. Before I began my translation, I happened to read Van Buitenen's translation, and this is the celebrated Nala Damayanti story where the Mahabharata says that Kali, as in the sense of Kali Yuga or evil, had entered Nala's body. And here was Van Buitenen translating it as Kali. And I read that and I thought, what? How can they possibly be Kali in the Mahabharata?
Right.
And this I give as an example to illustrate that quite often translations can also be wrong unless you get the nuances right.
Yeah.
And you have to get the pronunciation right. Like,
right.
Have people out here, most people, have you guys heard the term Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam? What does it mean?
World is one.
The world is one family. So I had a guy at a lit fest who'd obviously read it only in English. Okay, the term. So he told me Vasudeva Kutumbakam. Okay, that changes the meaning.
What does
of
that
the
mean?
Term.
It's nonsense actually.
Exactly. So you have to know it's Vasudha Eva Kutumbakam. Then it becomes, when you do a sandhi, Vasudha Eva Kutumbakam. You have to pronounce correctly, you have to translate correctly. It is intense work. But I'm saying the joy that we can get and the knowledge that waits for us out there is just waiting to be explored.
You know, earlier in the day, Professor Dinesh Singh, I don't know if he's here, you made a very interesting point about how Indians were sort of masters of the game, ancient India. And, you know, we seem to know everything that has come to pass now. From your reading of Itihasa, I will not call it epics anymore, what was it you think that the Indian mind had which gave it that ability to understand so many complex things that seem to be realities now?
Can I go for this?
Yes, please.
I have a theory on this. Two things, essentially. One, our education system realized the importance of the left brain and the right brain. Our present education system is just about the logical, rational left brain. Now, I know there are people who don't believe the left brain, right brain theory, but see it as a thing of things which train only your logical, rational, mathematical mind. Our education system does not train the intuitive, creative mind. But our ancient education system focused on both. Which is why you'll find like one of our foundational texts on mathematics, Leelavati by Bhaskaracharya ji. It was written in the form of Sanskrit poetry, right? So you're enjoying a poem as well, but you learn maths too.
You learn maths. With that.
The importance of marrying both was, I think, realized by our ancestors. That is something our present education system really needs to put in. We forget about training the intuitive, creative part of the brain. We actually deride it. We make fun of it. Right? That's something for, you know, that's nonsense. Too much focus on either doesn't work. You know, liberal arts, which does only, you know, post in your graduation level, but doesn't do practical mathematical stuff is useless. But doing only mathematical stuff is also not good. That's one thing. Second thing, our strong belief in that there's nothing beyond question. That was the way our ancestors lived.
Everything was open to...
Nothing was beyond question. There was no translation for the English word blasphemy in Vedic Sanskrit.
Right.
Because no one was beyond question. Not even the gods and goddesses. That attitude of questioning everything, that allows you to learn knowledge from anywhere. Because Saraswati Ma can bless anyone. Yeah, Saraswati Ma will not just bless an Indian, right? She can bless anyone. Learn from whoever you can. And have a questioning, curious spirit. And have that marriage between the left brain and the right brain.
Let me make two points. And the first point I'm making, because again, Amish said Saraswati, so this sparked off this thought in me. Much of this is beautiful, beautiful poetry. It was all poetry, very little in prose. Hmm. And sometimes we don't even realize Saraswati, shloka all of us are familiar with. Saraswati Mahabhage Vidye Kamala Lochane Vishwarupe Vishalakshmi Vidyang Dehi Namastute. We've all heard it innumerable times. Younger children, are you children? Younger, whatever. Are you aware? This sounds like indigo. Are you aware that this is Anushtup and that Anushtup had 8 aksharas in every line? Saraswati Mahabhage Vidye Kamalo Lochane Vakratunda Mahakaya Anushtup Vakratunda Mahakaya Ya Devi Sarvabhuteshu Anushtup. First line of the Bhagavad Gita, first shloka of the Bhagavad Gita, Dharma Kshetre, Kurukshetre, Samaveta, Yutsava, all Anushtup. You've heard these innumerable times without realizing that these are Anushtup. The next point that I want to make is if we look at our texts, there were texts that were written, composed, not written, that were composed by people who were in Vanaprastha. They were in Sannyasa. So they all composed the Upanishads, they composed the Brahmanas, they composed the Aranyakas, they were interested in Moksha Dharma. The average person then did not go off to the forest. The average person then was the householder, and the householder did what the householder does today. Make money, ensure that he can sustain his family. So he was not necessarily after Moksha Dharma. Dharma has multiple nuances. So if I interpret dharma in the sense of our going about our day-to-day life, in the sense of morality, in the sense of ethics, in the sense of what is good and what is bad, where will I find them? I will find them in the Ramayana and the Mahabharata and the Puranas. I will not go and look for them in the Ishopanishad and say, Ishavasyam idam sarvam yat kincha jagatyam jagat. That is the reason we should read these, because they tell us how to be good citizens. They tell us about governance. They tell us about dharma, artha, kama, not in the sense of moksha dharma, but in terms of what is proper and what is not proper.
Bibek, if I were to ask you, give me the text for economics. Give me the text you would recommend for governance. Give me the text you would recommend for diplomacy. Tell me, would you be able to give me that? Which the basic text that I should read or anyone should read?
You are asking for a text for dummies.
Yes, of course.
Now, obviously,
this is all 101.
Obviously, economics. These are texts that predated Adam Smith by several thousands of years.
But still they give you a basic sense.
So let's not use the word economics. And Adam Smith also was a professor of moral philosophy. If you are looking for one text, and particularly a text that has been translated, then one would obviously say Arthashastra. But as Amish said, on governance, there is plenty of stuff when in the Mahabharata, when Bhishma is lying down on his bed of arrows in Shanti Parva and Anushasana Parva and is instructing Yudhishthira and the others. There is stuff also in the Valmiki Ramayana. In the Valmiki Ramayana, Bharat comes to visit Rama. When Rama has gone off to the forest but has not actually left for deep inside the forest. And immediately Rama asks Bharat questions about what is the state of the kingdom. Are people happy, etc., etc., long set of questions. And there is a similar set of questions when Narad comes to visit Yudhishthir in the Mahabharata. And all of those questions are questions that you'd ask on the part of the government today. And in your early incarnation, you'd have included them in ranking of states in India today. Those are questions about governance.
And all of those
man or woman was supposed to be familiar with, and you go down that list, they would define an accomplished citizen anywhere in the world. From Vatsa and
Kama Sutra. So the point is this, you're not supposed to start giggling when you hear the Kama Sutra. Okay? Kama Sutra is actually also about it's in some way a text on manners, on fine living.
Right.
On that's what it is actually.
Luxurious living.
Kama. Yeah. I mean, how to experience the pleasures and the beauty of life. So what kind of person must you be so that you can actually experience the beauties of life? One can hear a beautiful Hindustani classical performance or a Carnatic classical music performance, and there could be some people out there not getting it at all, getting completely bored, looking at their Twitter feed. And there'd be some people sitting out there experiencing the highs of a lifetime. You know, so how do you get that bill? You know, what kind of attitude, what kind of personality, what kind of kalas you must have to lead a fine life, to lead a refined life? That's what Kama Sutra actually is.
In fact, let me sort of add on to that. Because if we look at these three purusharthas, dharma, artha, kama, the attitude in all of these texts was that there should be equilibrium between the three. Yudhishthira is actually told, and this is just meant to illustrate the equilibrium, Yudhishthira is actually told that as a king, 8 hours of the day should be devoted to artha, 8 hours should be devoted to kama, 8 hours should be devoted to dharma.
You know, when I heard this the first time, my question I'd ask, when does he sleep? I didn't get a good answer from my parents at that time.
Well, he sleeps after the kama. But, sort of adding to your question slightly differently, answering your question slightly differently, one of the most beautiful poets in Sanskrit is someone named Bhartrihari. Bhartrihari wrote very brief, perhaps I can call them verses, couplets almost. And there are three sets of 100. The first set of 100 is about love. Shringar Shataka. And the most beautiful poetry imaginable. The next set is about Niti Shataka. Partly governance.
Yeah.
And quite often you find these aphorisms being quoted without necessarily realizing that they are from Bhartrihari. And the Ras set is about Vairagya Shataka. And as I said, these are beautiful, beautiful poetry. Right at the end, I will quote a shloka from Vairagya Shataka.
Well, there's also
right at the Thirukural. End, okay, at the end of the discussion. This is after he learned Sanskrit at 40.
40.
What would he have done
if he'd started early, right? God. No, there's, and I'm sure everyone out here has heard of, obviously, of Thirukural by Thiruvalluvar. That also has beautiful couplets, poetries on three of the four Purusharthas, essentially. Dharma, Kama,
Artha. So there's a variety of
which all of us across should read and learn.
Yeah. The other thing that you were mentioning, Bibek, is that one of the most interesting things you found through this process of translation is that there is no right and wrong. I mean, that binary, you know, that we are so used to these binaries now. Good, bad, right, wrong. You didn't find that there, and that was very surprising to you. Want to elaborate a little on that?
Yes, I will.
Yeah.
But for example, let me give a different example. Incident everyone is familiar with. Hanuman comes to Sita in Ashokvan, bearing Rama's ring, and he's brought the message. And here is Hanuman wondering that now if I appear before Sita, she is suffering at the hands of the Rakshasas and the Rakshasis. If I appear before her, then she will take me to be a Rakshasa disguised.
Yeah.
So what shall I do? And he decides, and I'm certain, particularly the younger ones do not know this, he decides to speak in Sanskrit so that she realizes that he is not a Rakshasa or a Rakshasi disguised.
Because the Rakshasa spoke, they didn't
not
speak...
Not Ravana,
right, yeah.
Ravana did not originally hail from there.
Yeah.
Now, dharma has many layers, as I said. There is Varnashrama Dharma. There is some kind of notion of Moksha Dharma. Who am I? Why am I here? Where will I go? What is the purpose in life? And there is the day-to-day Dharma. One of the lessons from all of these texts is there is no absolute notion of what is right and what is wrong. Each one of us, faced with the same situation, may take a completely different decision, and having taken that decision, has to suffer the consequences. Bhishma, everyone knows about. He has taken a vow of celibacy of Brahmacharya, and the princess of Kashi, Amba, wants to marry him and says, if you do not marry me, I will immolate myself. And Bhishma says, I've got a vow of Brahmacharya, I cannot marry you. Amba immolates herself, becomes Shikhandi, we know that. What some people do not know is that Arjuna also had a temporary vow of Brahmacharya for a period of 1 year, during which time the princess of the Nagas, Ulupi, fell in love with him and said exactly the same thing. If you do not marry me, I will kill myself. Again, both Kshatriyas, both observing a vow of Brahmacharya, Arjuna decides to marry Ulupi. So here you have instances of different people taking different decisions and suffering the consequences. In other words, karma is just the flip side of dharma. And each and every instance that you can think of is a conflict of dharma. Each individual faces a conflict of dharma, whether it is Dronacharya, whether it is Duryodhan, whether it is Rama, and you take a decision. There is no absolute right or wrong, which is why today also we sit down and explore and speculate as to why did so-and-so take this decision, why not that decision. And this perennial message is innate in our texts. It is very alien to binary notions of right and wrong. Bertrand Russell was a famous philosopher. He wrote some short stories, which were pretty terrible, but they illustrated the dilemmas of the time. There is a story he wrote called The Boston Lady in 1972. Remember the year 1972. What happened? Well, 1972, there was the threat of a nuclear holocaust. Remember, this is a story and a bad story. There was a nuclear holocaust. It might be that the world would be wiped out. The human race would be exterminated. So someone from the West decides, let's have a plane filled with men and women flying 35,000 above the sky. And when the world is exterminated, when human species gets destroyed because of the nuclear holocaust, this plane will land and will repopulate the world and propagate the human species. As so happens, the plane crashes on an island. Everyone dies except for this lady from Boston who is pregnant. She delivers a son on this lonely island. No, before that, she delivers this son on this lonely island and she has this conflict of dharma. What do I do? Will I propagate the human species by having incest with my son? Or is that taboo? Eventually, she decides to have incest with the son. Unfortunately, the nuclear holocaust has been averted. The world has not been destroyed. A ship comes along to rescue them. And she comes back to Boston and is condemned by everyone. In the end, the Boston lady has no option but to kill herself. To anyone versed with our text, this story would have seemed complete nonsense. This dilemma, it's a perennial dilemma. It's not a binary right or wrong.
Right. Did you face that when you decided to reinterpret the story of Ravan? Because he, for us, is really the archetypal...
Ravan?
Yes.
No, but our impression of Ravan is driven more by some television serials.
Yes.
Okay, in the
1980s. Unfortunately, but true.
The original Valmiki Ramayan has a very nuanced take on him.
Yeah.
And he's in some ways a very interesting character. So I don't want to, go too much into it because then what will you guys read in my book then? which will come out by June, July.
No, think of it shameless as a trailer plugging for of your book.
Let me just say it's a nuanced take on a very, very interesting character. And there's something to be learned from every character, including Ravan. Including Ravan. And in our ancient way, we are not supposed to judge. We are supposed to learn. So there is something to be learned. And he was certainly very talented, very knowledgeable. He had a problem of an ego. So he makes for a very interesting character. And that's what I hope to bring out in this book. Which
was
will
it
be
exciting?
Out soon by the middle of this year.
Yeah. Was it exciting for you writing this? Did you discover things about Ravan which even you were surprised about?
I had read stuff on him, but obviously it's my take on Ravan. So I've enjoyed it a great deal because he's an extremely engaging character. There are some when the world causes them pain, they become even more noble, right? Like Lord Ram. And there are some when the world causes a cable person pain, they lash out in anger. And they are really capable. So their lashing out means a lot, actually. That's what Ravan is. Very interesting character. I've had a lot of fun writing it. I hope the readers like reading it as well.
Great. Quick promo that was. But
thank you. Shameless plugging.
Enabled by me, so it's okay. I'm going to end with a rapid fire for you, Amish. I know you hate them, but... I'm going to ask you to choose binaries, which I know you hate as well. But Ram or Shiv, the most exciting god and why? Bibek, feel free to step in, even though it goes against your better nature.
I think the best way to answer this is that Lord Ram was also a devotee of Lord Shiva, as am I.
Okay. Sita or Draupadi, the more interesting woman?
I haven't written on Draupadi as yet, so... Sitama.
Okay. Hanuman or Lakshman, who's more devoted?
Oh, tough call, man. Maybe Hanumanji?
Shrupnakha or Kekri, who's seen as more evil? Seen as more evil, not necessarily
But there is no evil in the Indian way. So no, I'm rejected. I'm not going to answer this question.
Ved Vyas or Valmiki, who's the better storyteller?
Oh, come on, you can't ask this. But okay, in the original way, I'm sure Bibek Da would agree. Valmiki ji was more poetic, in the way he expressed himself. And Vedvyas ji was more about conveying the philosophies. More, if you have to simplify it, he was more prose style. Whereas Valmiki ji, you know, you'd get the beauty of the expression as well. So I like the simpler, more philosophy-focused style. So maybe for that reason, Vedvyas ji. But it's a very difficult call.
And we're going to end with the promised Sanskrit shloka from you.
Do we have time?
Just 2 seconds. Yeah, I think we do.
Absolutely. For that Sanskrit shloka, surely.
I mentioned Bhartrihari and I mentioned 3 sets of 100 verses.
Yeah.
And I also said Niti, Shringar, Vairagya. Shringar I had better avoid here, it's being recorded. So I shall quote from Niti and I shall quote from Vairagya. Niti. Sahitya Sangeet Kala Vihina Manushya Rupe Pashu Puchya Vishana Hina Trinang Na Khadana Pijivamana Tad Vhagadeyang Aparang Pashu Nam Bhatri Hari. Those who are not interested in literature, singing and the arts are animals, even though they need not have tails and have horns. They are animals in the form of humans, and it is good for other animals that they do not actually eat grass. This is Bhartrihari at his cryptic best. Last one, Vairagya Shatak. Something to think about. Difficult to translate. Bhogana bhukta vayameva bhukta tapona taptang vayameva tapta kalona yato vayameva jata trishnana jirna vayameva jirna. We have not enjoyed objects of pleasure, instead we have been enjoyed. We have not tormented ourselves with austerities, instead we have been scorched. Time has not passed, instead we have been passed. Thirst has not been extinguished, instead we have been extinguished.
Wonderful. I think that's a wonderful way to end this. Thank you all very much for being very patient.